the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sins.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Shower, O heavens, from above, and let the clouds rain down righteousness.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come and help us by your might, that the sins which weigh us down may be quickly lifted by your grace and mercy. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for the fourth Sunday in Advent is from Deuteronomy chapter 18. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen. Just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, or see this great fire any more, lest I die." And the Lord said to me, "They are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words, that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him." This is the word of the Lord. Epistles from Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise. Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter. This is the testimony of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Then why are you baptizing if you are neither the Christ nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. But among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the gospel of the Lord. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit to the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our text is the gospel lesson, which has already been read. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Dearly beloved in the Lord, this is not an empowering sermon. That's the title for the sermon. And I just thought I should warn you ahead of time, because oftentimes people will come to church and they're beat down by the week before, the struggles, the testing, the temptations, and they're looking for something that will tell them you can do this, some sort of life hack to help them overcome, some sort of 10-step program, just do these things, and everything's going to be all right. I just want to feel empowered to meet the challenges ahead. And it is remarkable what humans are capable of, the potential. But I'm sorry, that's not what God's word reveals. It's not what this particular text reveals. This is not going to feel very empowering. Listen to John the Baptist. He says, there is a power. There is hope. And that power and that hope is in the Christ, the anointed one of God. Look at how this text begins. A delegation is sent to John the Baptist to ask, who are you? And his response is, I'm not the Christ. First words out of his mouth. Now, I don't know, if I came up to you, Joan, and I said, hi, my name is Micah Gaunt, who are you? You would say, Joan. You wouldn't say, I'm not who you're not. I'm not the Christ. Because the delegation clearly is wondering who is the Christ, and John knows this, and so he wants to put it out there and make sure they understand that it's not him. Don't focus on me, he's saying. But there is a Christ. So the reading bookends. So the beginning, he says, I am not the Christ. But there is a Christ, and then in the end, when they ask him, why are you baptizing with water? Or excuse me, first they say, why are you baptizing with water? John says, he answers, I baptize with water, but among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie. John's telling us today, his message is, he's not the Christ. There is a Christ. There is someone with the power. And he's coming for you. It's not explicit here, but you read this text and you really get the sense that the Jews had it all figured out. If you want confirmation, you just read through the rest of the gospel according to St. John. But you can almost imagine, we're told that the Jews, the Pharisees, in fact, had sent this delegation of priests and Levites because they hear about John and they want to know what's going on. They know God's word. They know the score. The plan. And so You can almost imagine that the night before they have sort of this powwow and everybody gets together and say, okay, so guys, hearing about this character named John, we gotta figure out what's going on here. We gotta manage this. So let's go out and talk to him. All right, sounds good. What's the plan? Well, we gotta figure out what's going on, who he is, what is happening. Okay, so what are we gonna ask him? What are we gonna do? I know. Say this. Who are you? Okay, yeah, I can handle that. All right. Who are you? Good plan. All right. So next day they're getting ready to go. What's the plan again? Who are you? Yeah, right. Who are you? Okay. All right. So this delegation comes. Here they are. And here's John the Baptist. I don't know who's the guy that they say to go do it, but hey, go. Okay, yeah, what am I saying again? Who are you? Okay, all right, right. There's John. Here's the guy. Who are you? I'm not the Christ. Wait just a minute. I don't know what to do with that. He just says he's not the Christ. Okay, all right. Well, the Bible says, the end of Malachi chapter 4 says that Elijah is going to come before the great and awful day of the Lord. So maybe find out if he's Elijah. Great. All right, Elijah. Are you Elijah? Nope. I'll be right back. He's not giving me anything here. I don't know. He says he's not Elijah. Okay, well, let's see. Deuteronomy. Moses said that God would lift up a prophet like him from among his people. So a prophet like Moses. See if he's the prophet. Are you the prophet? Nope. Then who are you? I'm the voice calling out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Now, I don't know what they do with that, but clearly it's not really helpful. And so they have one more powwow, and they finally say, listen, if you're not the Christ, if you're not Elijah, if you're not Moses, then who are you? We got to tell the people back home who you are. It's like they know. They've got it all figured out, and they want to know, where does he get off baptizing? You get the sense that these Jews have it all figured out. They know the score, how things are supposed to be, who's supposed to do what, and they start questioning John as if they're in control. You read the Bible, and you find out Jews thought they knew what was going on, but they didn't really. And the truth is, I've noticed this about the Jews and us. We don't have it figured out. We can talk really confidently. Listen to somebody talk about the news and politics. And we can speak in very confident terms of what the president needs to do, what the doctors need to do. We've got all of these. We know what's supposed to happen. Listen to people talk about COVID. I don't care which side you're on or where you're at. People will talk in very confident terms about COVID, and yet in the end, it's not changing anything. And this is the way it's always been. you look through the history of the world and people continually doing some impressive things, but then finally in the end, it still doesn't get rid of the sickness, the suffering. Nobody's stopping death. But people continue to be really confident. You have the Age of Enlightenment where people like Rene Descartes say, "I think, therefore I am." He sounds pretty confident about that. Friedrich Nietzsche, a philosopher in the 19th century, says God is dead, and by that he means that we don't need a God anymore. Humans can take care of themselves. We just need the Ubermensch, those supermen who can take care of business, because look at what we can do with science and technology and philosophy. Prince Albert, in the 19th century, the World's Fair. I think it was the World's Fair. I forget exactly what the circumstance was, but he was so enraptured with what science and technology could do. He was talking about the fact that we could, as a human race, we could get rid of poverty and sickness and all sorts of maladies that we face. And then, not too long later, a couple world wars, some more pandemics, nothing's changed. Terrorism. Country still at odds. The poor and the marginalized, still poor and marginalized. And we haven't fixed death at all. So confident about, it's easy to talk about the history, but look, it is easy for me, and I think this is probably true for you, it's really easy to talk about everyone else's problems. If you're in a conflict with someone, you know exactly what their problem is, you know what their sin is, you know what they need to do to fix it, but the interesting thing is, we're dealing with our own sins, and my sin hasn't been fixed. I'm not in control of my temptations and sin. All of this confidence, and in the end, nothing really to show for it. Just this last Tuesday in adult Bible class, we were reading through Isaiah 26. And Isaiah 26 has this great illustration to describe this phenomenon, where Isaiah says, "Like a pregnant woman who writhes and cries out in her pangs when she is near to giving birth, so were we because of you, O Lord. We were pregnant, we writhed, but we have given birth to wind. We have accomplished no deliverance in the earth, and the inhabitants of the world have not fallen." That's an image that communicates. You go through all the labor, all of the hardship of delivery, a child, and only have wind to show for it. No deliverance on the earth. And those who rule with unrighteousness at the expense of others, they have not fallen. That's the picture that we see in Isaiah. For all of our confidence about the way things should be, we haven't fixed anything. But God. Those two words show up throughout the Bible and are some of the sweetest words you'll ever hear. When we come to terms with our own weakness and inability to fix anything, we hear the words, "But God. So humans, that we the image that we have here is a woman who gives birth, but then just gives birth to the wind. Well, how about this? There were actually women in the Bible who, in fact, were barren. The Bible calls them barren. They could not have children. But God gave them children. And watch this. So Sarah, the first one, who's barren. But God enables Sarah to have a child when she's like 90 years old, and she gives birth to Abraham, who is the father of many nations. He is the father of the people of Israel. Abraham's a big character. Next we have Rebecca. She was barren, but she gives birth by the power of God. She gives birth to Esau and Jacob. And Jacob, we know his name gets changed to Israel, and so he is the father of Israel, the nation, God's chosen and holy people. Rachel is barren, but God enables her to have Joseph, who he goes from being a jail rat to the right hand of the Pharaoh, second powerful in all the world, and he saves the world from starvation and especially saves Israel. Hannah is barren, but God gives to her the child Samuel, who is a great prophet and priest and takes care of the people of Israel. Samson's mom, we don't know her name. She's Manoah's wife, Samson's mom. Israel is in bondage under the Philistines, and she gives birth to kind of a Hercules kind of character. Strong, can do things like no other man has ever done before. And then Elizabeth. As we're getting ready for Christmas, we hear the next one in the Bible we hear about is Elizabeth. Again, old lady. She's given up hope. And yet she has John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ. And then Mary. You don't get more barren than being a virgin. But God, in his mercy and his love, by the power of the Holy Spirit, gave into Mary's womb and to all humans the Christ, the Anointed One, the Savior of the world. Now, I don't know if you're keeping track. That's seven women. It's a good biblical number. Seven is the number for completion. But you know what? God's an overachiever. He really shows what he is capable of by giving us one more miraculous birth, the eighth birth, the number for recreation. The eighth birth was out of the tomb. You don't get more barren. There is no more barren womb than the tomb. Jesus, who lay there lifeless, his blood completely let out, bruised, nail-scarred, dead. Cold stone dead. But God raised him from the dead. And now Jesus lives and he reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true. He is given the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And all confess that Jesus is Lord. I'm not here today to tell you what you are able to do to fix your life. I'm here today to tell you what God can do. There is one who will accomplish everything we're longing for. Human potential is amazing, don't get me wrong. But there is only one who can take us who were in lonely exile from God, eternally separated because of our sins, deserving nothing from God, and yet has in fact done something about our sin that we could not remove or eliminate. There is one who has wisdom, and he's the one who rules all things, he's ordering all things, and he is the one who's teaching us, who's leading us. There is one who has true might. He was there on Sinai's height and in thunder and clouds and thick smoke. He gave the law, the way things are to be. There is one who frees us from Satan's tyranny. In fact, who gives us victory over the grave. There is one who rules. He is the key of David. Not only have we been saved from death, he also opens the gates to heaven forever. There is one who is the dayspring from on high, who cheers us by his drawing nigh. So even when we are in the midst of the gloomy clouds of night, when death's dark shadows comes to us, he puts them to flight. There is one. And there is one, friends, the desire of all peoples, who can take the hearts of all mankind and he can unite them. He takes the divisions and he removes them. There is one person in all creation who is able to do this. John's not him. I'm not him. You're not him. But there is the Christ. There is hope. So that's the message today. If you already have your life figured out, if you're in control, if you just need sort of a tactic to win, this sermon's not for you. But if you despair at your own sin and weakness, if you despair of the rulers of the world and what they can accomplish, then the message for you is rejoice. Rejoice. The Christ, Emmanuel, he shall come to thee, O Israel. In Jesus' name. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty and gracious Father, throughout this Advent season, we have heard that Christ has come in the flesh, that he comes to us today in word and sacrament, and that he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. Guide us by your Spirit that we may be kept firm in your word and faith until we are received into your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of truth, as your servant John cried out in the wilderness, strengthen our pastors also to preach your word of truth in the wilderness of this fallen world. We give you thanks for the men you have raised up for this holy task. Bless them in their labors, and continue to send workers into your vineyard, that there may be a bountiful harvest. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, preserve and prosper the schools of the church, that our young people may be taught to delight and treasure the word of God above all riches. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you delight not in the death of the wicked. Grant to us and to all people freedom from war and disorder, strife and rebellion. Give us good government, faithful magistrates, and peace to aid the swift spread of your gospel. Renew our hearts with thanksgiving for your many blessings, and grant us the wisdom to use them to fulfill your good purposes. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, teach us to make our requests known to you and to be anxious for nothing. Send your healing hand upon the sick and the suffering, especially Miles, Mary Day, Grace, Dick, Kara, Lee, Alan, Carol, Don, Mary, Karen, Jerry, Rose, John, Walt, Zach, Kay, Dee, Viola, and Lindsay. Guard them with your peace in Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of mercy and eternal life, be with all who mourn the loss of Pastor George Williams. We ask that in this time of mourning, they would remember the words that were put on his lips to proclaim. Jesus, who has defeated sin, death, and the devil, and who has won the victory for us that we might live forever, teach us all to be ever watchful for the day of Christ's return and for our summons, that we might all join together in the happy reunion with you. Lord, in your mercy. Grant, Lord, that those preparing to receive the Holy Communion may rejoice in the presence of your Son, our true Emmanuel, who comes to give us a share in your divine life and forgiveness by his body and blood. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all congregations, especially those in our circuit, remembering Zion Junietta. Bless pastor and people that they might continue to rejoice in the good news of the Christ who has come and will come again. Lord, in your mercy. Lover of the human race, you sent your Son into the womb of the Virgin that he might share our nature, forgive our sin, and destroy our death. Receive our thanks for those who have departed this life in faith and who now await the joyous day of his return. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who is both the root of Jesse and the righteous branch from his stump. By Christ's death, you have set him up as an ensign before the peoples to draw all to yourself. By his resurrection, you have silenced the kings who stood against him and taken away the power of death. Grant that as we recall with thanksgiving his advent in the flesh, we may always confess him and remain watchful for his advent in glory at the last day. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right and right, so to you.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose way John the Baptist prepared, proclaiming him the promised Messiah, the very Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, and calling sinners to repentance, that they might escape from the wrath to be revealed when he comes again in glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you, both body and soul, to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good,
and his mercy endureth forever.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.